Thank you, Arthur, for inviting me and also for organizing this wonderful conference, and thanks to everyone for being here. I'm going to speak about the reality of images, to be very precise, about my sense that actually the reality we live in consists of images. And why is this? Because images at a certain point have started crossing the screen and materializing within reality. And this is, they haven't, let's say, crossed the screen without transformation. In fact, they became profoundly transformed and bruised and damaged by crossing the screen. And this is why I think that the reality we live in fact, consists of the wreckage of images, no? of half destroyed, of images littering basically our reality. And I think this is connected to one development which people started noticing in the late 80s, namely that images became less, let's say, started less representing something that was there beforehand. They didn't record situations which were there, but they started catalyzing actions and events. And one very important scene that people described in 1989 happened in Romania during the deposition of the so-called Ceausescu regime. So what happened at this point in time, and there's this wonderful documentary by Harun Farocki and Andrei Uvica, called Videograms of a Revolution, which is showing us the scenes that happened. I wonder why we're not able to see them. Let's try again. Well, in any case, you know, you remember protesters, they stormed the TV stations, right? They didn't storm the parliament initially. They stormed the TV stations, and the records they produced, or the broadcasts, in fact, were not records of a previously existing reality, but they produced this reality. They created the reality in form of regime change, actually. Now let's see where we are here. At a certain point, I will need some images, so I'm hoping on the projector to start working. Having said that, I completely support the right of technological equipment to break down and strike, no? At any given moment. So I sympathize with this comrade who simply decided that he or she had enough at this point in time. But it leaves me kind of stranded. Let's try this again. Well, anyhow, I'll just keep talking in the meantime. This is fun. Okay. So the pictures of the Romanian revolutions, they were not records, they were not documents. They were catalysts of events, and since then it has become clear that images are not objective or subjective renditions of reality, of pre-existing conditions, but that they are rather nodes of energy and matter which migrate across different supports, which shape and affect people and also landscapes and, you know, social systems, whole political systems, and so on. So these images acquired an uncanny ability to proliferate and to transform and activate. And around 1989, television images started walking through television screens, as if they were a force wall, no? Right into reality. The situation is ongoing. It's a sort of parallel montage going on here. You see the reality, no, of the staging of this situation, the unsuccessful production of the image going on here, which has failed to produce any results to this point. So I'm going to continue talking. I still don't need, let's just leave it like that. If it works, we'll just deal with it. I mean, it's better having something than having nothing at all. So that's still from Harun Farocki and Andrei Uitzer's film. Why 1989? Maybe because the crossing of images through screens was something like a very literal translation of a process called transition. Transition is a term from political theory which served to describe political realities in Latin America, but after 89 was applied to Eastern European context, which, according to the point of view of transition, let's say the framework of transition, had to catch up. No, they had to belatedly implement democracy, free market, and so on. Basically, they had to transform into what a default Western nation thought it was. It was a sort of morphing process. They were supposed to adapt to an image. The results were very ambivalent, as well as the results of the transitions of images through screens. Not only protesters walked through screens into reality, but also this person here, who is presumably the first head of state, having walked through a TV screen right into reality. And if you look at him closely, then you also see how, as I said earlier on, images never cross the screen without getting bruised or glitched, because Berlusconi, I think he bumped his nose when he went through the screen, no? And this explains why he had to have so many procedures of plastic surgery afterwards, because the nose had to be fixed. And this also explains why plastic surgery as such is such a very popular operation these days, because so many people cross screens, no, and they bump their nose, and then there has, you know, one has to fix it somehow. So the point is not only that transition produces degradation, but it's also, I think more important is the fact that through this process of transition, images start to invade reality. They cross the screen. By crossing the screen, images become ubiquitous. They start inhabiting things, but also persons, infrastructure. They surround us, they are part of the environment, they are second nature, not only as pictures or projections, but as 3D objects or even in form of human bodies. And this means that we live amongst images. Let me give you one example. This is the example of military camouflage. Why is this a good example? Because camouflage is the art of blending with your environments, meaning that you have to know what your environments are in order to adapt to them. So this process is very well described in a short educational video. I'm going to show you just 2 minutes.
In this picture, there are 40 people. None of them can be seen. In this film, we hope to show you how not to be seen. This is Mr. E.R. Bradshaw of Naples, Black Lion Road, Southeast 5. He cannot be seen. Now, I'm going to ask him to stand up. Mr. Bradshaw, will you stand up, please? This demonstrates the value of not being seen. In this picture, we cannot see Mrs. B.J. Smegma of 13 The Crescent, Belmont. Mrs. Smegma, will you stand up, please? This is Mr. Nesbitt of Harlow, Newtown. Mr. Nesbitt, will you stand up, please? Mr. Nesbitt has learnt the first lesson of not being seen, not to stand up. However, he has chosen a very obvious piece of cover. Mr. E.B. Lambert of Homely, the Burrows, Oswestry, has presented us with a poser. We do not know which bush he is behind, but we can soon find out. Yes, it was the middle one.
Okay. So, I mean, this, I think, makes very clear why camouflage tells us a lot about the reality we live in, because if we do not adapt to it, if we don't manage to look exactly like a bush, let's say, then this might be lethal. So considering this, what do we make of this kind of camouflage and this are, of course, pixelated camouflage patterns, which have become almost ubiquitous. Almost every army in the world is now wearing a pixelated camouflage pattern, and this fashion kicks in, and it's a real fashion, actually, kicks in the 90s. The most popular digital camouflage pattern is called MARPET, worn by US Marines, and by internet law, this was developed by a bunch of snipers. The development of this pattern was outsourced to them, and they went to see a graphic designer and asked her, first of all, to create an image of a snow screen, meaning basically no signal. And the next thing they did is they went to a hardware store to look at paint swatches, and finally they picked a sample by a design by Rolf Lorraine called Coyote Brown, and that became the base of basically all digital camouflage patterns in the world. The thing is, if you don't have Coyote Brown, it doesn't work. So the interesting thing here is, what is the idea of the reality of the theater of operations, which is implied by this choice? It's a reality onto which, let's say, a layer of TV snow has already snowed down, right? Because you try to adapt to TV snow. And this is the one of the first, let's say, pieces of evidence to show that, you know, media has covered the world as if with a very, very fine layer of TV snow. And this is what you have to adapt to if you want to adapt to reality. There's, of course, a few complications, because as the Navy had a digital camouflage pattern, everyone wanted to have one. This came to be known as pixelated camouflage envy. And so the Army wanted to have one too, and they spent $5 billion on creating this pattern, which is called universal camouflage pattern. Only problem is that it didn't work. It never worked. It didn't work absolutely nowhere. This person here said, the only time I have ever seen it work well was in a gravel pit. But this is not true, because there is, in fact, one environment in which this form of camouflage works perfectly, and it's this one. So, and I think the situation we have portrayed here is very interesting, because you see someone who came through a TV screen, right, a soldier, and then he's completely confused, and he doesn't know where he is, and first thing he does is he plonks himself on the couch and tries to adapt to that. And this is also interesting, because it implies that the idea of the theater of operation of contemporary warfare of the US Army includes the TV couch. No, this is one of the major sites of military contestation nowadays. There are some improvements, recent improvements in camouflage technology. This is so-called active camouflage developed by Japanese scientists. As you see, it's still in a beta stage. It doesn't really work very well. But the idea is that a person is wearing basically a projection screen, a reflective cloak, and that an image of the background of this person is then projected onto the person itself, thus having him or her disappear and merge into the surroundings. But I think that actually the environment which this person tries to merge into is not these bushes or trees, like in Monty Python's example, but it's actually this environment here, which consists of cameras, of terminals, of projectors, of all sorts of networked pieces of equipment, so that the person actually tries to become a video installation in order to merge into reality, which tells us that reality is nowadays configured like it is a video installation, at least partially. So if soldiers by now largely camouflage as pixels, it implies that the world around them consists of pixels. Actually, they become pixels among pixels, thus revealing widespread pixelation also beyond screens, beyond networks, beyond displays. And that's not the only example. I will just show you a few others. This is a pixelated tank trying to pretend it's an 8-bit video game. This is civilian pixel camouflage, no? Also something that is becoming very prevalent. The assumption of all these things being that reality has turned into some sort of broken video game or maybe a Google Street View. This is actually very interesting. It's an artwork. It's a pixel mask you wear to become invisible from Google Street View. And this is a wallpaper, no, which also crossed the screen and became real. And this is a pixelated bed, which is taking the notion of being embedded, no, into a completely different dimension, a third dimension, so to speak. So one of the many consequences of this development, of course, I said this already, reality consists by now largely of images, of failed images, of things camouflaged as images, of constellations and processes which were formerly evident as images. And as they crossed the screen, they became transformed irrevocably. They were translated, they were misunderstood, they were senselessly inflated, or came under the axe of austerity. But this also means that we cannot understand this so-called reality anymore without understanding cinema, without understanding photography, 3D modeling, printing, all these, you know, imaging techniques, because these constitute reality now. The world is imbued with the shrapnel of former images. It's edited, it's photoshopped, it's cobbled together from spam and scrap. Reality is post-produced and scripted, and affect is rendered as an after effect. By now, we live within the afterlives of images. Now, there's a last consequence to this, because if reality is post-produced, and yesterday in this fabulous session with Laurel and Norm, we learned a lot about, you know, post-production and its various implications for contemporary reality. So if reality is post-produced, then it also means that we can change it by post-production. We can sort of reverse Photoshop it, if you like. No? We can intervene into reality with imaging techniques. And so this shifts the question, I think. So the question may not longer be what is represented in images or how do we read images. These remain important, no? Absolutely. But additional questions are, which images do we want to become real, no? As makers and producers and co-producers of images. How do we change reality by means of post-production? How can it be photoshopped, so to speak? How can it be edited? And I'll leave these questions for the discussion. Thank you.
I apologize in advance. I have to duck out promptly at like 3:45, 3:50, because I have to introduce a speaker on 16th Street. So if I run, it's not because I'm uninterested in the discussion. I'm sorry that we've only got half a screen, but it'll have to do. I'm trained as a political scientist, and I have a long-standing interest in how political identifications are made and remade. I have come to think that a lot of the work behind political subjectivities takes place visually, the idea being that our everyday looking, what we see when we walk down the street, flip through a newspaper, or look at Google Images, sets the horizon of political possibilities. Everyday looking inadvertently establishes the sense of where affinities are to be found and differences lie. It is these presumptive identifications that set the ground of politics for me. I draw on both found images and my own photographs. But my own photographs are definitely not intended as artistic creations. I think of them much more as fieldwork notes. I like the snapshot, the point and shoot, casual images, rather than the carefully composed, technically sophisticated, high-end images. I'm not so interested in the trained eye as I am in ordinary looking. I'm interested not so much in what I can do with images, but in a way that resonates, I think, with what Hito just said, in what images do to me. The agency for this research lies in the images. I follow rather than lead. But I don't think that that's so different from any of my social science research. A lot of what I'm interested in, the longer I've stayed in the business of doing research, is trying to find a disposition that remains openness to change, openness to rethinking what I went in thinking I was looking for. So I'm most interested in not so much, again, what I do, what I can do with images, but how they get me how they changed me. For several years now, I've been particularly drawn to photographs of the US-Mexican border. And I've just come back from a fieldwork trip to California, and I want to show some of these images today. These are pretty new, and so I haven't completely thought through what I'm doing with them. I'm still letting the images speak to me, so I'm actually particularly interested in people's reactions to the images themselves. Let me talk a little bit about where I went. This map is just a Google Images map that started at the San Diego-Tijuana border at a place called Borderfield State Park, which is a park created somewhat surprisingly by Richard Nixon in 1971 as part of his new federalism initiative, and it was part of his connection to interest in the environment, so it's set up as a nature preserve, and also a small subset of the border park as a place called Friendship Park that was opened by Pat Nixon in 1971 as a place where families could come together across the US-Mexican border and have sort of a more humane border experience. So I began there. I've always been taken by that place. And then we drove inland and ended up at Holtville, which is where inland about 3 hours from San Diego. So I want to show you some images from both of these places. The first one is this meant to move? Oh, down. Sorry, I'm used to a cross. Okay. As you walk in, you go through a nature preserve, and as you walk along with people, some people are doing birding, and there's kind of this muddy road with water on it. It's actually inaccessible to cars, so you have to walk in a couple of miles, and the border wall kind of follows you. And I've always been particularly interested in the second wall and other images like it that are all across the border, where the wall just ends abruptly. And it seems like an odd thing that it would just, if it's meant to keep people out, that they just stop. As you come over the crest of the hill, you come to what's known as Imperial Beach. And this is where the border wall goes straight into the sea. There's a couple of shots of this. Another one where the border quite literally sets the horizon of possibilities. This is taken alongside the wall. What interested me and somewhat took me by surprise when I went there was the degree of sociability across the border. There are a lot of kids playing on the US side. I went there on Easter Sunday, and there were large numbers of people in Mexico had gathered for Easter Sunday and were swimming in the beach, having picnics. Actually, as you walked in through this estuary, the first thing that you noticed, that I noticed and the other people I was with, was actually not the visuals, was the sound. There was all this Mexican music playing for the picnics and parties that had gathered on the beach. But I'm also intensely interested in this, the fact that we designed the border to be seen through. So it seems really reminds me of De Soto's discussion of the picket fence, where the gaps are as important as the walls, and that there's both simultaneously an openness and a prohibition. And that's true for most of the border fence, that there is this kind of double move in it, I think, an exclusion, but an engagement across the fence that's designed into the fence. I really like this photograph. There was both the sociability on the other side in terms of the picnics, but also very direct engagement of people trying to connect across the fence. So this is a guy, several people actually making peace signs, waving through the fence. This guy, you can't really see it when it's small, but he's actually smiling and trying to get my attention because he sees that I've got a camera. But the juxtaposition of people and fence is not always quite so lighthearted. There's a haunting, ominous quality to many of the border photographs. The next one is someone looking from the US side through to Mexico. I think the way that the head rests on the hand and the certain sort of sadness, I think, in the posture of the person looking. And that's true for many, many of the photographs. All of these are mine except for the four where, and I attribute them in the bottom. The next couple are not my photographs. This is from the New York Times. up until 2009, again, as I said, a lot of families actually reunited at the border fence. So this is someone coming to meet at the border to meet a new niece that's been born into the family. So they touch through the fence. And perhaps one of the most powerful for me is the effort to reconstitute a family through the fence with a classic family photograph composed with the fence running right through the middle. After being there for a while and looking at, spending many hours looking at tons of these images, I came to think that we always say that Eskimos have 100 words for snow. I think we have 100 words for no. And I began to collect images of all the different ways in which we say no. Perhaps my favorite is the top one in the middle, which is about the ocean outfill anti-intrusion structure. But there were many, many, just everywhere you looked, there was this sense of prohibition. Often actually buttressed by not just no trespassing, but all of these signs about danger and warnings in a sort of protective fashion, but that were nevertheless kind of generated a sense of fear. So that's the set of photographs for the border. The next set are moving to this place, Holtville, California, which, as I said, is about 3 hours drive inland and not so far from Yuma, Arizona, which is just a little bit further inland. So from 2001 on, we've been building a border wall more extensively inland, beginning with 14 miles. It was actually started a little earlier under Clinton in 1996, built a 14-mile wall in, and now we're building it further and further inland. And as we've built it inland, the border crossings have occurred more and more in the desert, in more and more harsh terrain, with more and more people dying in the border crossings. So the second place I wanted to go was to this place, Holtville, where there's a cemetery where they bury undocumented immigrants who die crossing the border. And many of the people who died, this is set in, there's, so I went from in the Imperial Beach and you go to the Imperial Dunes. We quite literally use the word imperial to surround everything that you see. It's Imperial County, there's Imperial Freeway. We're not too subtle about the terms that we use. But these sand dunes are, you know, kind of amazing, and they've had to design what they call a floating border wall. There is no bedrock to anchor the fence, and so there was a special design in which the border wall actually floats across the sand. So there are just a couple of shots of that, which I think are pretty amazing. I want to go back to Yuma, but where I went was this second place, which is this Holtville Cemetery. It's actually called Terrace Park Cemetery in Holtville, California. The front part of it is a very ordinary, quite small cemetery with headstones, sprinklers going, people tending the graves, and flowers. But if you walk through those gates that are at the back there, which I had heard about, you come to what's known as a pauper's cemetery. There's kind of a muddy field, and then these gravestones out the back. People were not so keen for us to go there, but if you persist, you can go see. And there are about 700 graves where, as I said, the undocumented who have died crossing the border are buried. Most of them are just marked with John Doe, Jane Doe, or Baby Doe headstones and the row number. There's actually a non-profit kind of political advocacy group called Border Angels that comes out pretty regularly and puts these crosses out, which just say, not forgotten. So it was a fairly stunning place to go and visit. Haunting. The images haunt me long after I've stopped looking, and they make me intensely aware of how little the border touches my life in New York. The affects generated through the border images are multiple and complex, at once playful and ominous, friendly and heart-wrenching. So I just wanted to end, I guess, so we leave time for discussion, with something about how I think about or why I've been drawn to think about images. Most of my research up until now was sort of regular text-based book writing. But there is something, it seems to me, in the image itself that captures what I is the essence of the political for me. And it's a double move that I think is possible in images more readily than I think it is in text. And that is, it's the twinning of both kind of, well, the way I would put it in a more jargonized term is that they're kind of semiotically open but affectively intense. And so that it's this mixture of openness and malleability to change, plus the psychic investment in them. And that with any one element of that, if it's just about an open reading and without the psychic investment, then politically it's not so interesting to me, that it's just things can change, people, you can read this different ways, but it's the change plus people caring about it, people being drawn to it. And similarly, if it were just the identificatory intensity, then you end up with sort of a more familiar identity politics in which people are deeply invested, but actually not so open to change. Mostly what I find really captivating about images is that I think they bring both of those two things together. They are intensely draw people in, and yet there is an openness, I think, in the way that they can be read. And it's that double move that captures my conception of politics and makes me want to work with images. Thank you. And it draws also on the work you were presenting today, but especially from your essay that I think probably many people have read, In Defense of the Poor Image, and then the exhibition that I saw at Eflux of yours. And it seemed to me both that you play a lot with, in a way that I find very intriguing and interesting, both the sense of the circulation of images, as in the defense of the poor image, that circulation's a thing. It's really important to have low resolution so that we don't end up in so many problems like we did today, that these images can move rather than high resolution PDFs that you can't send anyway. And that there's something about the kind of power and political force of images that comes from circulation rather than resolution, as I took to be the main kind of thrust of that. And yet in the exhibition pieces, there was also a way in which you a lot of the force of both the video installation, I don't know how many people saw the exhibition, but also the work on Adorno and the protests in the 60s kind of thing, and the way you work with that, that those were anchored in quite specific historical moments. The murder of your friend, so that you draw both on context and kind of decontextualization in some ways, as you were saying in the prior session. And I would love to hear you talk a little bit more about how you walk that line between contextualization and decontextualization. Seems to me a kind of crucial image, a crucial question.
Thanks a lot for the question, also for the fantastic presentation. I think I'm going to try to answer that in a very abstract way, because so maybe if we think of images as something which has both sort of dynamic energy. Both a component of matter and a component of energy, then I think accelerating them, you know, stresses the component of energy inherent in images, of speed, of affectivity, of circulation. But there is also a way in which images slow down and become literally objects, no? And for me, it's interesting to explore both. Mm-hmm. Both. How do images materialize as objects? And on the other hand, how are they accelerated to a point where they are basically hurried blurs, so to speak, no? Affecting people.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Interesting. I don't know whether we keep talking or maybe it'd be, why do you want to run the session given that we're sort of out of time? Maybe we should just open it up straight away. And I should duck and go and introduce my guest, I think. Okay.
Well, Are there questions for Hito from the audience?
No, there aren't.
Yes, in the back over there.
Could you speak more maybe about I was asking about images as objects proper and how they would relate to other objects in the world. You started to talk about images and objects, and I'm really interested in that idea.
Yeah, I mean, basically, I don't know, right? But there are a few things that became interesting to me. The materiality of images, for example, the fact that most of the images that we see, I mean, this has come up so much in the previous discussion. So the materiality of images, right? The fact that, I don't know, many images are printed on DVDs, on CDs, on aluminum, so to speak. So there's lots of different material carriers which locate images within networks of objects, of forces, which are connected to one another, which form assemblages. That's one aspect. The other one, which I really haven't fully figured out, is what sort of object is an image? Of course, you know, there is the aspect of the carrier, of the material network of support that an image necessitates. But what sort of an object is an image itself? I don't really know. It's a very complex object. And even more interesting is the question, what sort of object am I as an image? I'm not even going to try to answer that.
No questions? Yes, over there, to the right.
I think I wanted you to talk a little bit further about the idea of image and network, and whether or not images have ever existed outside of a network, and is the idea of an isolated individual image is almost a complete abstraction. Mm-hmm. So, you know, and if you think of it that way, when you're looking at a degraded image or a fine art print, that there's relationships there always have been, mm-hmm. and they collectively speak together when we often interpret them as an object that's presenting meaning by itself. So I don't know if you could talk a little bit more about how the collective idea of imagery and network. Mm.
Yes, I completely agree. I think an image as an object is something which has been described by Soviet writer Sergei Tretyakov when he wrote an essay called Biography of an Object. So he described an object as a sort of meeting point of forces, but also materials. And I think that this is one way in which to understand images, as this meeting point, you know, in which these forces contradict at a certain point in time or come together. Of course, you know, but for me the interesting thing is now we're talking a lot about the circulation of images within networks and so on, but I think for me one of the most interesting aspects is how do they trickle beyond networks also. No, they are, even if they circulate within, let's say, the internet or whatever sort of networks, what do they do beyond these networks? How do they leak, no? And also the other way around. I mean, the other way around is much better understood, I guess. It's taking pictures and uploading them. But how do they materialize? That's interesting for me.
Well, I want to thank you. And I apologize for the technical glitches. Thank you, Hito.